We Can Do Better on BCTV is supported by Hyde Villa Auto Parts, the local Napa store.
Hello, and welcome back to the Camel Project's We Can Do Better show. My name is Pam Gockley. I'm executive director. We will not have my co-host on, Brad, for this segment, but just to be a little bit clear, you know, because we have to reinvent because of Zoom. So this show is going to be done in two parts. We're going to interview, I'm so excited to interview our next guest, but in the second part, we'll be interviewing Christopher Paul, who has experienced bullying in his life. He's an older person, but we asked him to reflect a little bit about what's happened to him being in the LGBT community and reflect back on a little bit. And he's gonna be a great interview. So stay tuned for the second part of this show. So just to talk a little bit about the Camel Project, we have a couple steps we want to go through the community. Our first step is awareness, building awareness about bullying and other aggressive learned behaviors. Our second step is to create community-wide strategies for prevention and to unlearn these learned aggressive behaviors like bullying and other behaviors. And finally, when the whole community comes together consistently and has a continuous support for each other, not just our kids, that's when we can eliminate these aggressive behaviors and specifically bullying. So just to go through our agenda a little bit, we have about what's happening with the Camel Project. We have started a anywhere school supply drive. So if you go to thecamelproject.org, you'll see there's a couple things you can do. You can donate money and sponsorship. You can donate a $25 donation so we can build what we're calling a camel pack instead of a backpack. And these camel packs will be full of school supplies for middle school, and that's who we're targeting. So there's a list of suggestions in there. Or if you can't afford that, we understand, but if you want to donate a pack of pencils or pens, our kids in this county, in Berks County, will appreciate anything you can give, and we'll put the packs together. We are being contacted by numerous agencies and children's youth organizations who have a need. So we will be donating them to the organizations like Big Brothers and Big Sisters, and they can donate it to their kids in their community in need. The second event we're having is the Community Champion Awards. That's going to be November 3rd at the Community Foundation on 3rd Street. We have three recipients. Go to thecamelproject.org to find out who. Unfortunately, the presentation is limited to 25. We will be presenting the awards, but afterwards, we will be having a car parade at 2:00 on Saturday, October 3rd, and we will be starting at the RAC parking lot on North 2nd Street. The Reading Police Department has been very cooperative and very happy to help us out with traffic control. So all are welcome to the car parade. We have the Corvette Club coming, and we have the American Automobile Classic Cars coming, and we believe a motorcycle. So this is going to be a blowout, high five, smiles required. And we're going to meet down there like 1:00, and they're going to stage and then come around the block. So, and finally, and I can't wait to get organized, is the Camel Trot, the 5K run fun run. That's going to be at the Reading Airport, November 22nd. We're going to start at 10 a.m. We're going to be social distancing all our events, social distancing, mask required, mandatory, not a question. Just please wear the mask. If we have more than the 250 people right now, last year we had 200 people, we're going to consider starting two times, starting at 11, 1 at 10 and 1 at 11. So those are the events coming up for the end of this year for the Camel Project. We're so excited that we can get back to work, and we're so excited about the anywhere school supply drive. Just to be clear, even they may not, the kids may not be in the building, they still have to have school supplies. And unfortunately, kids usually is dependent on their teachers to give them supplies. And this year that may not be available to them. So we want to, you know, jump in there and bridge that gap. So without further ado, I am so excited to introduce you to Miss Amie. And Miss Amie is going to now introduce herself. So Miss Amie, please tell us more about you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Miss Amie. I've been around for a long time. I know I don't look that old, but makeup does wonders. I've been performing for, I don't know, over half my life at least at this point. I'm 24. Maybe. And as part of what I've been doing in my illustrious drag career, I recently, I guess about 2 years ago, started Drag Queen Story Hour here in Berks County. Drag Queen Story Hour has been a thing for quite a number of years. I believe it started in 2015 out in California, and then the East Coast kind of caught on, and the next thing I knew, I saw these little blips of people reading stories and singing songs, and I was like, can I do this? And so I reached out to some people, and here we are. So I've been going all over the place, singing songs and reading stories about being nice to each other and, you know, just instilling kindness, planting little seeds of kindness, because the world needs a lot of kindness right now. Can I sing a song quick? Would that be okay?
Oh, please. I was going to say, can I impose on you to kind of show us what you do? Because the Kettle Project is about teaching. It's about showing. So please, thank you so much.
Yeah, I'll sing one of my, one of the songs that I sing, usually to start off my programs. It's an old, old, old song, but it's still relevant, especially nowadays. So.
With love, grow apple trees and honey bees and snow white turtle dove. I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony, and I'd like to hold it in my arms and keep it company. I'd like to see the world for once all standing hand in hand, hear them echo through the hills for peace throughout the land. That's the song I hear that the world sing today. Oh yeah. I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. La 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 la.
Should start every morning with that little clip and do the kids. Uh-oh. Yeah, I think we should do that. I'm gonna do an app, and we're gonna start every morning with Miss Amie, that before you leave the house or leave your room, you have to listen to Miss Amie and sing along. I was saying, oh my gosh, that was so awesome. Thank you. So do the kids sing along? I mean, is that what happens normally?
There have been some kids who know that song, but it's generally like the older people, you know, who bring their kid. They're more familiar with that song, but people sing along. And then I have, you know, other little songs I play, like if you want to hear a story, clap your hands, and you know, we do that, stomp our feet and shout hooray and do wiggles, and yeah, we get up and moving, and then we have little dance parties at the end. Sometimes we'll do the hokey pokey or the locomotion or something silly and fun. I mean, and you know, kids be asking questions, you know, pointing stuff out that they see in the stories, and we have a great time.
That is so awesome, because I think creativity is one of those really required things to help kids lose the aggressive learned behaviors, or maybe help them deal with the trauma they may be living with. So do you like go out for performances right now, or how are you getting your message out? Because this is not something you just arbitrarily start one day. This is deep within Miss Amie that she needs to do this. So just tell us a little bit about what you're doing right now and how people could get a hold of you.
So since all of the chaos, you know, started with no one can go anywhere or do anything or be out in public at a performance. The last, I think May was the first one. I started doing just Facebook events and just Facebook Live, a story hour. So I did one in May, and I did one in June, and I did one, did I do one last month? Yes. No, I didn't do one last month. Last month was a little crazy. But I actually just finished one before I got here with you, for Allentown. Well, Lehigh Valley's, Pride is today. So we did that. And it went super well. And same with my Facebook events, you know, live streaming, and I get, you know, people saying thank you, and I love this book, I love that song. And even prior to the Facebook Live things that I was doing, I had recorded radio shows at WXAC. And so I had the audio from that, and I put slideshows together of like the pictures of the books that I read during the programs and other pictures of me at, you know, other events around town, you know, doing things here, there, and everywhere. Just so people had something to at least listen to with some visual, you know. So that's kind of what I've been doing the last couple months. And then I've also been like putting on little tiny things, like little smaller shows outside of my house, because I live on a nice big corner and I have lots of neighbors with kids, and they've got porches. So everyone like kind of sits on their porch or grabs a blanket, and everyone's, you know, kind of socially distant, and they sit around and watch, and I, you know, entertain the neighborhood, because I got a little bored not entertaining people, because that's kind of what I do. So,
and that's awesome. And first of all, I wrote a children's book, so I don't know if you would be open to sending that to you. It's called A Blaze of Kindness, and it talks about my kitty cats are in it, and we had a 15-year-old from Hershey High School do all the illustrations, because I don't draw. So again, instead of teaching, we show, and she did a storyboard. She did a phenomenal job. So all the proceeds go to the Camel Project if anybody would want to purchase them on Amazon. But I will talk about that later to you, but I did write a children's book, so.
It sounds like it's right up my alley.
Yeah, and it's called A Blaze of I don't give away the secret, but there's a bully in the backyard of all the animal friends my kitty cats have in the backyard. So this was supposed to be a series of five, but I got kind of tired after one, so maybe two. But so we want to talk about, we talked about what you do. Just can we get a little bit into, are people resisting the idea, or are you open with, can you talk just a little bit about what we have to do better now, what we have to overcome in our community?
Initially, when I first started the program, I didn't seem to have too much counter, like, not kindness. But as I did more programs, more people who are not of the same mindset started showing up, And then at one of my big events at a library last year, there was a lot of angry sign holding, shouting on bullhorn people. And it's upsetting. 'Cause like some of these people even like make their way into my programs just to take up space. So people who want to be there and enjoy it and get these wonderful kind messages, they can't come in because there isn't any room. And these people sit there, and even though they're there through the whole program, through everything that I do, they still don't see it for what it is, which is a person, you know, reading stories about being kind and singing songs that make people smile. So it hasn't stopped me. It makes it all that more affirming that this is something good that the world needs right now. You know, I wish more people could not be afraid of whatever they're afraid of that makes them think that something like what I do is scary, you know, because it's not at all. Like, if you scroll through pictures of like events that I've had, you know, because I've like little albums on my Drag Queen Story Hour with Miss Amie Facebook page. These kids just, they wait in lines to get up to see me, to sit on my lap, to give me a hug, to give me something they colored. They're just so happy to be there. And it doesn't matter who I am. I could literally be anyone, and they wouldn't see any difference. They just see a nice, kind human being. The end, you know?
Well, and I think that's, you hit something. First of all, what we can do better is be a little bit more open-minded. But we found many, many of the bullies, not the target, but the bullies are afraid. Now, people aren't born with fear. Fear is created through isolation and not having the curiosity to accept others. And to the Camel Project, that means they are not accepting themselves. So that's where this prevention strategy comes in, and helping to expose children to other things, to not be afraid. They're not putting Miss Amie in a category that is fearful, because kids are intuitive. Then they know your aura and your karma, and they know when they're kind, and they know when a person they're a little bit afraid of, and they don't have the maturity to know why. So this is why it's so, in my opinion, incredibly important that you please keep doing this. And anything the Camel Project can do to support you and promote you, because I think that song should be on an app, and every morning these kids, and they all have cell phones. People are like, they don't have internet access. I'm like, well, everyone I ever saw did. And just start this app every morning to start with this mindset. So I'm talking way too much, because I'm just thrilled that somebody locally in the Berks County area is doing this, and these kids have access to something different, that they can actually have the information to make their own decisions. So so what's the future for Miss Amie? I mean, we are going to come out of this COVID thing at some point. Is there like a world tour we're going to go on? Are we just going to stick? I mean, are we going to take over the world? You know, the Camel Project is, so you're happy to come along. But what do you have like plans short term and long term?
I'm just kind of going with the flow right now. you know, I'm doing little things here and there when I can. And once things start to open back up, I plan to get right back in doing things out for the public, you know. So until then, I mean, we've got Facebook Live and I've got my socially distant, you know, little things on the corner outside of my house. So we'll see what happens. I do have some real big things in the works. So, and I mean, they're even like socially distant events, you know, in and of themselves, but at least it's out and about, you know, rather than just I'm walking outside of my door. Hello, neighborhood. So I'm just waiting.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, with the Kennel Project and all our things had to be canceled, we're just trying to, what we've been doing is reading what other people are doing and kind of doing the same thing. So, you know, we're trying not to reinvent it, but try to make it obviously safe. So, yeah, like I said, we look forward to it and, you know, make sure you check out her, Miss Amie's Facebook page as well to find out what's going on. I think exposing our children to other cultures, other mindsets, other things. And I found when I talk to younger kids, they don't have any of the negative thoughts or the fear. And I'm hoping we can catch them before they're taught that. Adults are a little bit harder. That's just another part of the Camel Project I don't want to go into right now. So we always want to ask our guests, what do you think we could do better in our communities? What is Miss Amie's take on that?
What can we do better? We can be, like I said, open-minded. We can absolutely be more open-minded. And try to not be as afraid of things that we don't understand. If something frightens you or scares you, I've learned that the more you educate yourself, the more you expose yourself to those things that are scary, you learn to not be afraid because you're learning whatever it is really all about, you know? Like, I mean, even, not even talking like ideas that are scary, but maybe like a spider. Like if you're scared of a spider, I used to not like spiders, but then as I got older, I was like, wait a minute, spiders are good. Spiders do things that help us as people. They get rid of nasty bugs that hurt us. And even though spiders could hurt us, they generally don't. So now I have this little rule with spiders. If there's a spider in my house and I see it and it's up where it's supposed to be doing its job, I let the spider alone. But as soon as the spider breaches eye level with me, then I do everything in my power to make sure that lovely little spider gets to go outside where it belongs to do its job elsewhere. But even ideas and things that you don't understand, if you just research things, read stuff, hang around people who, you know, are familiar with those ideas or concepts or what have you, you know, you'll learn to not be afraid of it anymore. And maybe some things, you know, are not within our ideologies, but at least you educated yourself and exposed yourself to learn whether or not something is for you or whether it's not for you. But even if it's not for you, it doesn't mean you need to hate, you know, those around you or be fearful of those around you who have those ideologies.
And that's what we found when fear continues to grow, it goes into hate. And, you know, this doesn't happen in a week. This happens over consistent silence, you know, nobody counteracting that. And I really think that's, I know I'm not a doctor, but that's what I feel helps kids when they hear a story or a book being written or exposed to something that's not normal, but not in their regular routine. And that support and that encouragement from a community is where the Camel Project really thinks that all these things come together. I'm not going to dress up and read a book to kids, but we need to do that. So it's so great to know there's that resource. I'm not a psychiatrist, you know, I'm not this, I'm not that. But if the Camel Project can bring all these things together, we really think that's what our role should be. So I don't quite have to ask you this, but how did you come up with this idea? That might be a hard one, but how did this, I mean, reading books to kids, how did that happen?
I mean, it wasn't my idea. I just kind of jumped on the bandwagon. But I felt, because a lot of the other story hours are very transgender forward, being who you are, how you feel inside is normally a pretty good clue. Listen to yourself, reading stories about other kids who feel the same way or don't feel the same way. But then there's a lot of other books that are just about being kind. So I've kind of, at least because of our area, I figured focusing more on stories and songs about kindness was a better direction to go. Not that I don't read some of the other ones, because I do, I absolutely do, but I'm very heavy on anti-bullying and just kindness and being who you are and loving yourself. Because there are other people out there who are also different, and different is not bad, different is good.
Yeah, different is good. And, you know, we had a guest on who was focused on teaching teenagers about sexual health. And she said, you know, when you go to have that birds and bees talk with your teenagers, or before teenagers now, she said it can't be one talk. It has to be a series of consistent reinforcement and maybe growing more in depth as you go. So you can't like have one talk, you know, had the birds and bees talk, done, we're finished. No, it needs to be consistent. And that's why I think having these kinds of programs available more often, I think is great for the kids. Now I have one more question. And I don't know if you will or not, but could you do another song?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yay.
Of course. I'll sing my favorite song.
There you go.
I have to move my capo though. I stole this one from Kermit.
Look what it's done so far.
Okay, so now we have the app they have to listen to before they go to bed. So we have a night with Miss Amie. Oh my God. And you know what? I'm not saying what you do is easy, but folks, this is not that hard to engage children. This is not that difficult to get those kids to move from a negative to a positive. It just escapes me sometime. And I'm so happy that you are on so that people can see how easy this is. So I'm incredibly proud and honored that you have taken the time to share what you do. And I really want people to know there's options and you don't have to be stuck in that negative. We call it the trauma spiral. We want to be that interruption, and whatever that interruption needs to be, we want to be able to connect people with that. So it escapes me why this is so hard for folks to discover how we can make impact on our kids. So I want to leave you with a couple minutes. Just any last thoughts. We want to make sure if you're interested in contacting Miss Amie, look her up on Facebook and give her a contact. Tell her you saw us on the Camel Project. We can do better show. Let her know where you came from. And the adults, I think after you hear that last song, I don't know how you can be negative anymore. So even if it only lasts for a minute and we crack the wall just a little bit. So, okay, I'll stop talking now and I'll give you a minute to just summarize, and then we'll end the show and we'll go into part two, and we'll listen to Christopher Paul's story. And maybe you two should be introduced sometime. Let me know if you want that to happen. So any last words, Miss Amie? Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, I had a great time being here. Thank you for having me. And, you know, I can't say it enough. Just plant little seeds of kindness. I just got a new book, actually. My cousin was going through some of her old books, and she gave it to my mom to give to me when she last saw her. And it's about, it's called, I can't remember what it's called, but it's about everyone goes around with an invisible bucket, and that bucket gets filled. You get a full bucket by doing kind things or receiving kindness, but you can dip into other people's buckets when you're mean and you're not nice. But dipping into somebody else's bucket doesn't fill your bucket. It doesn't make you feel any better in the long run. And the only way to fill your bucket is to do nice things and receive nice things, because we all want to treat each other the way we would want to be treated. So just plant seeds of kindness, fill each other's buckets. I wish I would have brought the book with me to show you and just read a little segment of it, but it's on my list of books that I'm going to read very, very soon, because it's just too good. Yeah, be kind. That's really all I have to say. Just be kind, love each other, love yourselves, and that's the end. It's that simple. It's really that simple.
Well, I want to thank you again for joining us. And you know, we have a teaser. So you want to know what the name of the book is? You got to tune in to Facebook Live to see what Miss Amie's name of the book. That could be a trivia. That could be, you know, you got to come in and find out about your bucket. And a lot of times, you know, kids don't even know what kindness feels like. So, you know, we got to be, you know, kind of aware too. And I know if you grew up in a family, a strong unit, a family unit, a big family, you have to recognize there's kids that don't know what that means. There's orphans, there's, you know, kids with parents with problems. So we just need to recognize that not everybody has grown up the way you are, and they may not know what kindness feels like. And it may be scary at first. And they may act illogical, and they're kids, and we're supposed to be the adults to be able to recognize that. So I'm sorry, went off there. Don't know where that came from, but again, I want to thank you. And folks, I want to remind you that all the information will be on the CamelProject.org. This will be posted through the BCTV as well as YouTube. And we'll notify you when the video is up, but please stay tuned for the second part of our show. We can do better. What can we do better? with Christopher Paul, who will tell and share his story about being bullied as a youth in Berks County. So thank you so much for joining in, and I look forward to seeing you next time.
Welcome to the second half of We Can Do Better. I want to thank Miss Amie for a terrific interview. We really had fun talking with her. Hope everybody enjoyed it. Our next guest today is Christopher Paul. Christopher has had a life experience of bullying and has a story to tell. And we're going to find out about Christopher's life and see exactly what has happened with him, how he's persevered, and what he's doing to overcome bullying in his life. So welcome, Christopher.
Welcome. Hi, thank you for having me.
Welcome to the show. And yeah, Miss Amie was awesome. So maybe we can introduce you to at some point. But yeah, so if you could talk to us a little bit about your experience being bullied. We want to educate folks in Berks County so that we can make sure everybody is kind and compassionate and has empathy. So go ahead, if you don't mind sharing your story.
Sure. So I went to Catholic school most of my childhood and the first part of my high school years. And as I got older and kind of was really struggling to fit in more and more, people noticed that I wasn't exactly like everyone else. My interests were a lot different than the majority of other males that were my age. I did have a lot of female friends. Pardon?
How old were you at that point?
I'm going to say I was about, well, I mean, it started early on, but the bullying kind of progressed more and more by the time I was like 12 and then first starting high school. So once I went to the high school then, all of the Catholic schools, well, there were two at that point. It was Holy Name and Central Catholic. Now it's Berks Catholic. So certain schools went to Holy Name and other schools went to Central Catholic. So now that we're all in the same building, I'm not just with my class anymore. There's all sorts of new students that we kind of knew each other from sports and things and other, you know, activities with the other schools, but we'd never like gone to school together. And now there were other people who were older. Some of them I knew because they were at my school, you know, before I got up to the high school. But there were a lot of people that I didn't know. And those people were not very nice to me. And I would get, you know, snickers in the hallway. I got pushed down a flight of stairs, once and was hurt pretty bad. But nothing ended up happening to that student. I think he got maybe a detention or something. And the outcome of that situation, according to the school, was that I was the one who, needed the help because I wasn't right in the head. So they sent me to get like shrinked, you know, they're gonna fix me, which my therapist thought was absolutely ridiculous. So then I just got to leave school early and get, you know, some stuff off my chest. But after that incident, the principal was a nun, and she went out of her way to make me feel uncomfortable. I even heard things from like teachers sometimes, like under their breath. Nobody really did anything to, you know, stick up for me. I had friends who, you know, loved and supported me, and they did whatever they could in their power, but it reached a point where I was starting to get blamed for things that were happening around the school by this nun, to the point where I was in tears one day during a rehearsal for our school play in the fall. This was the beginning of my sophomore year. And I had to go back to school the next day. I didn't want to. But I guess my mom had called and had it out with her. And so she called me into the office, like one of the first, you know, periods of the morning. And she basically said that you don't belong here, you don't fit in, and you should leave. And I got up and said, if that's the way you feel, okay. And then I went to the door and I turned around. I said something not very nice and then slammed the door and left. But I handed in my books the rest of the day. And then I ended up going to Why Missing, where I had friends who were football, you know, players and lifeguards and swimmers. And like I had a community there of friends who stuck up for me. And then I didn't get really any flack from anybody, except maybe some underclassmen who thought that they were all cool. But the administration at Why Missing didn't tolerate that at all. So the rest of my high school experience was so much better than what anything up to that point had been, with just, you know, this small-minded, like, conservative background. Most of these, and I can't say that about everyone, because most of the kids that were like in my class, like, yeah, they didn't really like bully me, but there was definitely, like, you know, a little bit of picking on here and there, and that's sort of normal kid stuff. I don't feel like it was anything meant to really cause any sort of harm when I was younger. But as soon as we got to high school, things changed completely. And that first year and a quarter or so was very, very hard and very traumatic for the things that I had to go through and then be blamed for when I really didn't do anything wrong at all. Like, these kids would walk by my classrooms and the teacher would be facing us and we're facing the doors, and they're making very lewd and obscene gestures, like, through the windows. Everybody else can see it and they're laughing. And, like, you know, it was hard. It was really, really hard.
I'm really sorry that happened to you. And, you know, we're starting to, the more we delve into the bullying thing, right, there's a level of immaturity of picking on people, you know, and I'm not sure that's bullying. But then when you get to the adults, it just seems to me we really need to change some of the mindsets of the adults. And
did your life improve as you got older after high school, or what happened there?
So after high school, I went to college at Kutztown for a couple of years. That was a fantastic experience. I didn't have any problems there. You know, we had an on-campus LGBT center, and where our little group was called Allies, and I helped to get the drag shows started up there when I was younger. And because that was a whole thing, like, people were like, let's do stuff, and I was like, I'm an actor, like, we can do some stuff, I guess. I think I'm okay at it. I look pretty, maybe. I don't So we started doing that sort of stuff up there, and then as I branched out more into, like, because I went to school for theater, so I wanted to just get out and start doing more stuff. And I started getting parts, and I started, like, getting hired to do gigs and stuff all over the place. And then I don't know what happened, but somewhere along the line, I must have done something better than someone else. And the next thing I know, I was getting, like, attacked by all sorts of different other people trying to knock me down and take, like, what I was doing away from me so they could try to do it even though we were kind of working together, and they learned what to do from me. So that was kind of hurtful. There was a lot of cyberbullying, you know, really nasty things being written or posted, or, and like, I felt like I was back in high school again. So I was also attached to a person that a lot of people didn't like, unbeknownst to me. Mm. Well, not that I didn't, I knew people didn't like him, but I didn't know why until I started getting abused in my relationship and marriage. So again, I ended up back in a place that was horrible and traumatic. And luckily that's mostly behind me now. And since that's been out of my life, I've kind of taken off and flourished in all sorts of other directions. I got involved with some really awesome other actors in the area, and we just filmed a movie last year, which is now streaming on Amazon, and that's so cool that I can be like, I'm in a movie on Amazon. Like, so
what's the name of it?
It's called Dust Nuggets.
Dust Nuggets. I will look that up.
It's trippy.
Good. Good.
But it was all filmed here in Berks County, mostly.
Oh, really?
So
Very, very.
How did you persevere from getting from the relationship that was a bad and abusive relationship to kind of escaping that and turning your life into a better place for you? How did that transition take place?
Slowly.
Did you have outside help, or was it mostly internal and you took care of it yourself? Or?
Excuse me. I reached out to a lot of people to find a direction of how can I get the emotional support and help that I needed to be able to work through, you know, building myself back up, because people who abuse people excuse me. They really like to knock them down a lot. Mm-hmm. And that's what took a lot of patience. I don't know what is wrong with me. So I just kept building up my circle with positive people.
Mm-hmm. I think that's incredibly important that people get that you need supportive people around you. And it's not easy, and it doesn't happen instantly. It takes a lot of work. Nobody goes through any of this by themselves. I don't know how some people are, you know, think they're isolated. And a lot of time when people are bullied, they self-isolate because they don't want to get hurt. But I think it's incredibly important that you need to find adult people who are mature and who are supportive of you, and you hang on to them and you be nice and you make sure you have that support group around you. Absolutely. I think critical.
Mm-hmm.
And Pam speaks from a place of experience, by the way. She's had significant bullying in her life, so she understands pretty much where you've been. Did you have any outside organizations that help? Were there any local organizations that you reached out to?
Yes. Safe Berks was a really big help. I also was up at the Bradbury Sullivan Center in Allentown. They had a good program for people who were victims of domestic violence. Mm-hmm.
Do you need to take a drink? Go ahead if you need to take a drink.
There is something just so stuck. I don't know what it is.
We're very laid back. It's like we're sitting in the
living room
just having a chat, you know, and people's throats get dry and we're all good. You know, I'm waiting for my cat to race through the screen. So yeah, it's all good.
In 1 second.
Sure. So I just think, Brad, that is so incredibly important that when you're bullied, and especially with adults doing it, who then kids will kick right in. Sure. Because they see the adults doing it. But the way that you get through this is make sure that you have a support system. Doesn't have to be the same type of people. It doesn't have to be in the same circles. The more connections and the relationships, which is really hard to create with somebody who's been bullied, because relationships hurt. You know, you just don't want to go back. You don't want to go back there, but you need to learn the signs that you learned and reflect on what happened and how did you get in a relationship? Not that it's your fault,
right?
But how did you get into an abusive relationship? And who is that person, and identify it and make sure you have red flags going up all the time. And even if, you know, you overreact sometimes, if you're supposed to be in a relationship or a friendship, it'll persevere. If not, it next, you have to make sure you pick that. So,
and family makes a huge difference too. What was your family like during this time, Christopher? Were you getting support? It sounds like your mother was at least supportive at high school at some point.
Yes. My family has always been very supportive. Especially my mom's side of the family. They're very artsy fartsy people. So they were always there if I needed somebody, you know, and I spent a lot of time with my grandparents and cousins and aunts and uncles growing up. We're still very close. My grandparents passed away recently, within the last 2 years, my grandfather first and then my grandmother. A couple months later, unexpectedly, so that was really hard, because she was like, I mean, they were both my number one fans, but she was,
yeah, really in your corner,
waving flags every 5 minutes.
That's awesome. That's really awesome.
So yeah, I had good support from my family.
Yeah, and that's incredibly important, I think. So I had the support of my mother, and my mother passed away 8 years ago. So still think of her every day. But just one day I had an epiphany, you know, woe is me, who's going to support me? You know, she would tell you about me even if you didn't care. That would be my mother. You know what I mean? So I finally just one day I met a kid who was homeless, and I thought, come on, it's now your time to take the torch and support people who need it and to read that. So now, if you would talk to somebody right now who is in the same situation that you were as a sophomore, what would be a piece of advice you would give?
Oh boy. I'd say find those people that you know love you and support you and stay with them. Don't let anybody else try to tear you down for anything that makes you who you are, you know. we're all different. We don't all look, we're like flowers. Flowers kind of, you know, look the same-ish, but they're really not. Like, there's no two flowers that are exactly alike. There's no two snowflakes that are exactly alike. But, like flowers and snowflakes or whatever, we're all made from the same things, and we all need those same things surrounding us to help us grow and thrive and be happy, healthy, you know, people throughout our lives. Mm-hmm. And if you can find those people and you can hold on to them, that's really all you ever need, because you'll always have somebody there. It can be hard to, you know, have to deal with being bullied or picked on, but people who like to put other people down are usually afraid of something that they don't like about themselves. And they have to try to bring you down to their level and make you feel as bad as they do, because they probably don't have the love or support that you have. And that's kind of like the main message of stuff that I've recently been doing. I might drop a little bombshell right now. By the way, I'm Miss Amie.
What? No so way!
I do the drag queen story hour things. I read these stories and I play the guitar. And we soak up goodness and love and, you know, just spreading kindness, planting little seeds of kindness, because that's what the world really needs right now.
That's terrific.
We all need to learn how to love each other, respect each other, and just treat each other like human beings, because that's what we are. We may not all look the same. We may not all dress the same. We may not like the same foods, but like I said, flowers, snowflakes, we all need the same things to make us who we are.
Wow.
How did you begin doing Miss Amie?
Pardon?
How did you begin doing Miss Amie?
It just kind of fell into my lap. I've been doing drag for a very long time, and I started hearing all this like hubbub on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. These drag queens are reading stories to kids. And I'm like,
what?
Hold on a minute. I'm the oldest on both sides of my family. So I was constantly surrounded by children. That was my job as, you know, ringleader. I have to gather the minions, and we would put on little plays and, you know, whatever. And I would help out with after school care programs growing up, you know. And so when I saw that this was like becoming a thing, I'm like, do I know anybody in my circle who knows somebody that is in the library system? Turns out we did. So my friend hooked me up with her friend, and she was like, I've been trying to find somebody to, you know, do this. And I was talking to some people and they recommended you. And now here you are. And I'm like,
hello. That is awesome. That is so awesome.
It just kind of whirlwind. People were talking about me. I was talking about it over here, and ta-da, it happened. So
awesome.
I started Pennsylvania's first official story hour chapter in, 2018, 2017? I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I think it was 18. Was it? No. 17. I don't know. It's been a while. But we debuted at Reading Pride a couple years ago. And yeah.
Well, that's awesome. And congratulations. And I can't believe we're almost out of time. So, but yeah, that's incredible. Gosh knows we need kindness and people tolerance and resilience skills and kids to be exposed and adults to be exposed to different. And it's not bad. It's a good thing to, broaden your horizons and get rid of that one world view that we seem to be clustering back to. So before we wrap it up, we have one final question for Christopher or Miss Amie Brad. Our question is, what can we do better? So what can we as adults and what can we as a community in Berks County do better to accept kids who are different or within the LGBT or whatever they are? So what can we do better?
Be understanding and patient. when you're a young person struggling to figure out who you are, and you get bombarded with views of that's not right, or that's a sin, or there's something wrong with you, it doesn't help. And they're just, I don't really see it a lot now. And maybe that's just because of the people that I have in my circle. Because if any of them had a child who was LGBTQ+, it wouldn't matter at all. Mm-hmm. Still their child. And the kids that I see, because I have friends who have, children and stuff. Their kids don't pick on each other. Like, they're always supporting one another and helping each other do stuff. And that's what we need. We need to support each other. We need to be more understanding of each other and just treat each other with the respect that we would like to be treated with by anyone.
Do you think there's more acceptance even now in the high schools than when you were there? I mean, I know it hasn't been that long, but do you think it's changing? Is there a shift?
For sure. When I was at Wyomissing, the only gay straight alliance in the high schools was at Reading High. So we would, like, different schools that wanted to participate would go to Reading High for these meetings. Up until just last year, Wyomissing still didn't have a GSA.
Wow.
And one of my friends' kids was a senior, and him and his friends were like, why isn't this a thing? And I saw this petition on Facebook and I was like, whoa, 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 whoa. There hasn't been another single LGBT student at Wyomissing since me.
Yeah.
So I'm like, cause I was trying to get this stuff going, when I was there. And it just astonished me that all these other high schools in the area have them and Wyomissing still didn't. And I was like, what? So with the help of what they started, and I jumped on board, and now Wyomissing finally has a GSA. I was one of their first guest speakers last year. Came in, talked a lot about this stuff, and kids just asked me questions, and we had a good little Q&A thing. But yeah, there's a it's since I've, you know, graduated. Things are moving in a much better direction for acceptance and support. So.
Great. And, you know, I appreciate you sharing your story. So if somebody's interested in bringing Miss Amie, now it's you, if somebody's interested, what is the best way to contact you? Facebook or?
Yeah. I'm on Facebook. I'm on Instagram. You can type in Drag Queen Story Hour with Miss Amie on Facebook. I'm Amie Vanite on Instagram. It's AmieVanite with a little over it, but you probably won't get that. I mean, even if you do, it's fine. And Twitter as well.
Fantastic.
Oh, YouTube. I'm on YouTube too. You can go on YouTube and watch me do stuff.
Awesome. But anything to wrap it up, Brad, any last thoughts or ideas?
Just thank you, Christopher. It's been really great talking with you. Enjoyed hearing your story and sorry for your trials and tribulations, but I'm glad to see you really overcome and are in a much better place today.
Thank you. I'm flourishing. I'm living my best life and I'm loving it.
Thank you so much, Christopher. And we appreciate you being on the We Can Do Better by the CAMEL Project, the Bullying Eye Care Program. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anything coming up, Pam, that you needed to discuss for our organization?
We have we are actually collecting school supplies for middle school kids. We're going to take the CAMEL Caravan out. We're going to collect supplies. We're looking for sponsors. We're also looking for people to volunteer, and then we will be distributing, we're calling them the Camel Pack. So if you want to go out to one of the stores, because we're having we're calling it back to whatever school, you know, whatever the kids are doing, they're still going to be in school. So we're calling it the Back to Whatever School Supply Drive. So if you want to, you know, make a contribution of supplies, or if you want to donate money, we'll make them. And we have some nice sponsorships for some businesses who may be interested. And we will then be distributing them at specific dates and times, not to be announced yet because we're not sure. And then you can follow us on Facebook as well, The CAMEL Project, and on our website, thecamelproject.org. So that's all I got, Brad.
Sounds good.
All right.
Thank you. Good show.
Thank you again, Christopher.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
We Can Do Better on BCTV is supported by Hyde Villa Auto Parts, the local Napa store.